Right.
Let me get my lab coat on. Okay, let's rap now.
Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Yeah. Processing your brain. Let everybody try. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Yeah. Rule that lab like a fair science lab.
Yes, sir.
I hypothesize, experiment,
test the question,
analyze,
damn, look at the results,
report,
here it is, tell them what you learned,
bring that lab here, y'all,
Bunsen burn.
Wait, isn't that the scientific method?
Yeah, that's just another way of saying it.
Got it. Observe. You ask a question and then start to theorize. Think an educated guess about the question in order to hypothesize. When you experiment, test the question, then analyze or study what happened. Finally, you can report the results, share it in writing, and then start
rap now. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Put the process in your brain. Let's get everybody trying. Think like a scientist, think like a scientist. Yeah. Rule that lab like a pure science scientist.
All right, here's my experiment. What can I use to stop an egg from breaking when it's dropped?
I don't know.
Well,
observe. What's the question?
Could bread protect an egg if I drop it?
Hypothesize. Make an educated guess.
I bet three slices would ice stop it.
Experiment. Try it out.
I had to drop a lot of eggs.
Analyze.
I can keep the egg safe with five slices of bread.
Report, share the data. Don't keep it in your head.
Graphs, pictures, and writing earn you real scientist cred.
I'm a scientist. Think like a scientist. Put the process in your brain. Let's get everybody trying. Think like a scientist. Think like a scientist. Cool that lab. Like a pure science lab.
Ask a question.
Hypothesize.
Propose an answer.
Experiment.
Test the question.
Analyze.
Bam. Look at the results.
Report.
Here it is. Tell them what you learned.
Yeah. Bring that lab here, y'all. Think like a scientist. Think like a scientist. Yeah. Processing your brain. Everybody trying to think like a scientist. Think like a scientist. Rule that lab like a fair science lab. Yeah. Think like a scientist. Think like a scientist. Yeah. Processing your brain. Everybody trying to think like a scientist. Think like a scientist. Rule that lab like a fair science lab.
Rule that lab.
What you gonna eat that?
Really just five raw eggs cracked on a loaf of bread.
I could put it in the microwave.
That's really gross, bro.
All right, my loves, welcome to Science with Miss Hernandez. I'm so glad to see so many of you here today. And I cannot wait to continue our discussion about the scientific method. Sorry the video was lagging. I did link it into your agendas and playlists for today so that you can access it and jam out to such a cool song anytime you like. Stay tuned though. Miss Pritchard and I may be challenging some of you to a dance-off. Now, you guys remember that observation that I made yesterday about how I kind of get a little bit out of breath when I dance? We're going to be talking about that a little bit more, but before we get started with that, I did want to take a moment to go over a couple things with you guys regarding your Echo classrooms. So, when you click on each of your teacher's Echo classroom, at the very top of the classroom, you should see these banners. Miss Chalfont has one at the top of hers. I have one at the top of mine, and Ms. Zielinski has one at the top of hers. Now, these banners are interactive. That means that you can click within these documents. So, and if you guys could monitor the chat for me, I would appreciate that. So, the first thing is to email your teachers. You're going to click the little email icon that is in each of our banners. So if you need to email Ms. Zielinski, you're going to click her email icon. If you need to email me or Ms. Chalfont, you'll click our email icons in our banner, which is at the top of the Echo class. You can you also have a link to your teacher's Zoom room. So if you want to Zoom Ms. Chalfont during her office hours, you'll click hers or mine or Ms. Zielinski's. Remember, it's at the top of your Echo classrooms. Also, if you guys want to see your week, your assignments for the week in a big picture format, we each have the weekly playlist linked into our banners as well. Got a couple other hidden tools here. We also have links to Rapid Identity in our classrooms. I need to add that to mine. But if we ask you to log into NC EdCloud, you can just click on that link and it'll take you right to my.ncedcloud.org. And you can make sure you're logged in there, because sometimes we forget to do that before we go into Echo, and then it causes all kinds of problems. So it's nice to have a quick little shortcut there so we can log in. Last two things are your interactive notebooks. Your interactive notebook for math is linked in the math banner up at the top. Your interactive notebook for science is linked here under resources in the science one. You will be using that on Friday before you take your quiz, so make sure you know how to access that. And if and when Ms. Zielinski has her interactive notebook, if she would like to share it with you that way, it will also be in her banner as well. And then last but not least, Ms. Zielinski also has one other tool that she utilizes in her classroom that we don't necessarily need, and that is Quill. Okay, so a quick link to Quill in case you've got to complete a Quill assignment. All right. So now that we've covered that, this is very helpful for you all. So please utilize that tool whenever you feel lost or need a little bit of help. Don't hesitate to send us an email or hop into our Zoom room. So we're going to start our science lesson today with some review from yesterday. So in your assignments, we had two types of data. They were quantitative and qualitative. So the first one we're going to review is the quantitative one. And the root word that's in quantitative is quantity. And that word means the amount or number of a material. In qualitative, the root word is quality. And when you talk about the quality of something, you're usually talking about a distinctive attribute that it has or a characteristic. So, like, spots would be a characteristic or an attribute of the dog. Also, that they are young. That would be describing them. That would be the quality of the dog. Also, whether or not they are small or large, that also tells the quality. All of the choices that you should have had under quantitative should have been that they slept an average of 8 hours, because there's a number there. And that their size increased from 6 to 11 inches, that they ate 4 pounds, there's your number there, and that there are 4 dogs in the group. Now, we're gonna make a connection here to math. Who can tell me what type of data talks about numbers or quantities in math? And you can comment in the chat or unmute yourself. And yes, I am recording. Thank you for asking.
Numerical.
Fantastic. You guys are on it. So quantitative, it has an N. And it is your numerical data in math. And we call it quantitative data in science. And they both have the N there talking about the numbers. Now, qualitative data, when we are talking about qualities, how we describe something, what type of data would that be called in math? So you have your numerical data, categorical data, and your data over a time span. Which of those would relate most likely to qualitative or quality?
Something that changes over time. Data that changes over time.
Okay. All right, so I see you're saying data that changes over time, but I'm getting a couple of different answers in the chat. I've got a couple categoricals and numericals. Okay, I'm getting a lot of categoricals. Somebody who said categorical, can you explain to me why you think it's more categorical than data that changes over time? You can unmute yourself. You don't have to type it in the chat.
Are you talking to me?
If you said categorical in the chat, I'm talking to anyone who has said categorical, because I see a bunch of people saying that. Okay, I've got lots of people commenting categorical, but I need some reasoning. I need some why.
Kaylee's got her hand raised, and so does Ocean.
Okay, go ahead and call on. I can't see that. Ocean, can you tell us why? Why do you think qualitative would be more like categorical data in math?
I think it would be more categorical because, let's say some people have brown eyes and some people have blue eyes. Mm-hmm. That's like in a category, so, and it's part of their, not their traits, but...
their genes?
It's a quality.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And if you're born with brown eyes, do your eyes usually change colors?
No, not normally.
Not normally. Some people might have hazel eyes, so they kind of go back and forth between blue and green. But most of the time, the color eyes that we're born with are the color eyes that we keep for the rest of our lives. So qualities really aren't something that we think of as changing over time. Yes, something might be young and then get old over time, but when we talk about qualitative data in science, we're talking about in the moment that the experiment is happening, the qualities that the specimens possess. So yes, you are correct that would be more like categorical data, okay? So we can classify the different things into separate categories: blue eyes, green eyes, brown eyes. Very good.
Excuse me, Ms. Fernandez.
Yes, Cameron.
So the reason that I wanted to tell you my reasoning for thinking that it was data that changes over time.
Okay, yeah, sure.
So the reason I thought it was data that changes over time is because a quality can always change. Just because it has that quality right there and then, it doesn't mean that it can't change right there and then. When you were a baby, when you could have been crying and then and it could have changed as soon as you started crying. You could have just stopped. So there's a reason why another reason I thought it might have been data that changes over time is because if you look at the little boxes below on the other screen, mm-hmm. one of them said like the dog's size, the dog's over a month, the dog's size increased. And that's another reason I thought maybe qualitative was meant like data that changes over time.
Okay. So I really like your reasoning there. But I hope that I was able to clarify a little bit for you that when we look and we make observations in science, that it is just in that one moment. When the observation
yeah.
is taking place. This piece of data here with the dog size, since it's talking about it increasing from 6 inches to 11 inches, that one will actually go under numerical because in science, we don't really, when we're talking about our types of data, we don't really talk about the data that changes over time. But you're exactly right. If we had another category, then it would definitely go there.
Okay. It was just kind of, I was just trying to like explain my reasoning for saying the data that changes over time because it just kind of came to me as that.
Yeah, I appreciate you sharing your insight. That helps me to understand too a little bit of where you're coming from and maybe even your classmates. So thank you for that.
All right.
Yeah. All right, so your next question said a hypothesis must be blank. So your hypothesis must be, most people answered correctly on this one, but some people said that the hypothesis must be right. And that was not the answer that I was looking for. Somebody tell me why a hypothesis may not be right sometimes. Someone who I haven't heard from yet.
You've got Braxton, Samira, Elliot, Kaylee, all have their hands raised.
Okay. Did you say Haley?
Kaylee and Jamari.
Okay, Kaylee, I haven't heard from you here recently. Why might a hypothesis not be right?
A hypothesis doesn't have to be right because it can be right, but it doesn't have to be. Because if it's not right, you can come up with another hypothesis. And if it is right, it's right.
Okay. So we can kind of determine whether the hypothesis is right or wrong. A hypothesis is just an educated guess. So upon further testing, it could be right or it could be wrong. So the best answer for this question was that a hypothesis must be testable. All right. So when we talk about the scientific method, scientists go through a certain series of processes in order to answer a question or find the answer to the hypothesis or decide whether or not it needs to be retested. So the first thing is that a problem has to be identified. So yesterday, I made an observation, and you guys probably made the observation as well, that I was tired after dancing. I was just out of breath. I could barely talk. The YouTube video had to take over for me. And so I asked the question, why are we so tired after dancing? So that question then would prompt me to think of an answer. So a possible explanation to the problem. Maybe we're tired after dancing because we, I don't know, didn't get enough sleep last night. Or maybe we're tired after dancing because we use up all of our oxygen by dancing. Or maybe we're not getting enough oxygen while we're dancing. So it's simply a prediction that has not been proven or disproven. There's no facts to support it or debunk it. But it must be stated in a way that is testable. So we get tired after dancing because we don't breathe in enough oxygen because we're too distracted dancing. That would be a good one because you're implying that maybe you're too distracted dancing. However, you could say we don't get enough oxygen while we're dancing. And there's definitely ways that you could test that. Please make sure we are remaining muted as your teacher's talking. So then scientists like me and you, we would then perform an experiment. And we would have a control group and an experimental group. And the control group would stay the same, so they would just dance in a regular room, and then maybe the experimental group would dance in a room with a higher concentration of oxygen to see if they get tired as quickly as the people who are in the regular oxygen concentration get. So one group stays the same, you're expecting the results to stay the exact same, and one group changes either their environment or what they're doing, something like that. And then you record or analyze your results. So as the experiment's taking place, you're writing down, you're taking note of any of that qualitative or quantitative data that you're noting. Oh, it took subject A 10 minutes to get tired. It took subject B 5 seconds to get tired. And then you would have to decide if the data supported or did not support the hypothesis. And then, da-da-da-da, you can draw a conclusion and report your results. So you'll use your evidence or your observations from the experiment to determine if the hypothesis is supported or not supported using the evidence from your experiment. We must repeat our experiments over and over because we have to get the same results in order to prove our hypothesis before we reach a final conclusion about any type of hypothesis that we create. You can't just conduct an experiment one time and just assume that, oh, yep, I was right. Because anything, human error could happen, and we'll talk about that more later on this week. So now, we are going to apply this to what's going on today. So what I want for everybody to do right now before I get started is I want you to make sure your hands feature is put down, your hands are down. And Ms. Zielinski and Ms. Chalfant, if you can help me when I ask the question to monitor who raises their hand and just ask them to unmute themselves so they can answer. All right, so what problems have you observed in the world today? And there's a hint there.
Elliot?
Maybe like COVID-19, maybe like how troubling or how hard it is to do, maybe like get some people, maybe it's troubling with how hard it is to do Zoom, but maybe just mostly COVID-19.
Okay, absolutely. Biggest problem facing us today is probably definitely COVID-19. It has completely altered the way that life has been in the past for us. So, my next question is, what questions do you think have been asked by scientists regarding COVID-19?
Fumi?
That was for the question from earlier.
Okay, do you want to take a shot at it and see what questions do you think have been asked by scientists? What would a scientist ask if they had this problem, coronavirus?
Maybe what type of symptoms, and I don't know. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, what kind of symptoms? That's a great question.
Definitely. We definitely have to understand the virus in order to be able to do anything about it. Excellent. I'm also seeing some coming up in the chat. Braxton says, how can we cure the sickness? Reagan said, how can we make an antidote, which is a cure for the sickness? So you guys are right on track. So what medicines do we need to mix, or what medicine can we create? Or what medicines do we need to mix to create an effective vaccine? So, knowing that the coronavirus is a problem, we've observed that, and scientists may be asking the question, what medicines do we need to mix to create an effective vaccine? A proposed hypothesis may be that I think medicine A and medicine B will create an effective vaccine. So, after they come up with this hypothesis, they're like, oh, well, I know this about the virus. I know that these symptoms occur. Very good, Fumi. I know that these symptoms occur, and I know that these medicines cure these symptoms, and they also get rid of a virus that's similar to coronavirus. Can we mix these medicines to get rid of the coronavirus? So what they would do is they would first test it in a small lab, not on people, but when they start to think that they may be onto something and that they are onto a vaccine that may cure this horrible virus, then they may start to do test groups on people. So our example says, in order to test the effectiveness of a new vaccine, 50 volunteers are selected and divided into two groups. One group will be the control group, and the other group will be the experimental group. Both groups are given a pill to take that is identical in size, shape, color, and texture. So first of all, we're going to identify the experimental group. What are we going to be experimenting with? What are we going to be experimenting with, hypothetically?
I see Naha's hand is, oh, Naha just put her hand down. Guys, put your hands down after we answer the question.
Okay, so I'm seeing here that we've got maybe people or pills or a different medicine. Different medicines may be our experimental group. Let's find out. So, yes, the experimental group, and you guys are both correct, the people who said people and the people who said pills, because the experimental group is going to be the group of people that receive the vaccine. So there's two pills. One pill has the vaccine in it. One pill does not have the vaccine in it. It's just kind of like a fake. And nobody knows whether they've got the vaccine pill or not. So the experimental group is the group that's receiving the vaccine. What would the control group be? Remember, this is the group that stays the same and there are no changes. What would our control group be? If the experimental group is the group that receives the vaccine pill, sorry, people say pill funny. So. Okay, so the control group may be what? Raise your hand if you know who the control group may include.
Nellie's hand is raised, and we also had a couple of people comment in the chat.
All right, Nellie.
The control group may be the people that, they may be the people that are, like, controlling how much medicine the test people take, or they might be controlling, how they're different and how they make them. That's how they're controlling.
Okay, I like where you're going with that, but let's think of the control group as a group within the experiment. So normally when we think of controlling something, we think of like a controller on a game or somebody controlling somebody's actions or motions, but the control group is actually a group that is controlled within the experiment. So if the experimental group are the ones who are receiving the vaccine, and I think I'm seeing some in the chat. Yes, I see quite a few people in the chat. The control group is actually going to be our group that does not receive the vaccine in the pill. They're going to receive the fake pill. So you've got two pills that look the same. The experimental group is going to get the medicine, and the control group is going to get a fake pill. It's not going to have any medicine in it. So the things that are going to be kept constant in this experiment is what? Let's read this example one more time. It says 50 volunteers are selected and divided into two groups, control group and experimental group. One group will be the control group, the other will be the experimental group, and both groups are going to be given a pill to take that is identical in size, shape, color, and texture. So what is going to be the same for both groups? What is the same for both groups?
Medicine.
Okay, the medicine. Elaborate for that a little bit for me, Samira.
The last words, if both groups are given the pill to take that identical in size, shape, or color, and texture.
Okay, thank you for identifying what exactly you were talking about, because you are absolutely correct. When you said medicine, I wasn't quite sure, but yes, the variables that are going to be kept constant is the size, shape, color, and texture of the pill. That's going to be the exact same. However, what is going to be changed for each of those groups? So they're both going to be receiving a pill. What's going to be the difference? What's going to be the variable there? DeMario, do you know?
Minus face is different.
Okay, yes, Samira, make sure you wait until you're called on before you unmute yourself, okay? But if both groups are receiving a pill, one group is going to get something different than the other group in order for us to have an experiment. So what is going to be the variable that's changed between the groups?
Colin, would you want to say what you put in the chat?
All right, yes. So one, I am seeing in the chat that some of you are right on track that yes, one group, both groups are getting a pill. One is going to get medicine or a vaccine in the pill. The other one is just going to get a placebo pill, which means that there's going to be no medicine in it whatsoever. So one's going to get a fake and one's going to get the real thing. And then we're able to compare the results. So today, you guys are going to have a spin at watching a little girl, an awesome little girl named Ada Twist, and she, did I say watch a video? You're going to read a story or follow along with a story about an awesome little girl named Ada Twist, and she thinks like a scientist from the moment she's born. What I want for you to do is to explain how she thinks like a scientist, and don't just say that she has experiments, because remember, scientists do a lot more than just conduct experiments. They first make observations, so they notice something, and that causes them to ask a question, and then they form a hypothesis and they make a prediction. So you're going to explain to me, you're going to try to identify the different steps of the scientific process that Ada goes through in the story. Does anybody have any questions about this assignment? If you comment in this box, and by the way, your response goes in this box and then you'll submit, but if you just comment and say she conducts experiments, I'm going to give you a zero and return it to you with feedback that says that this is not acceptable work. I want to see you try to analyze all of the pieces of the scientific method in the story. So if you do not have any questions for me, you are free to go. Thank you so much for paying attention to your lesson. But if you do have questions, hang out, and I can't wait to talk to you.
Bye.
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 Bye-bye.